I'm Quentin Hardy, and it's my great pleasure to introduce tonight's guest, Daniel Franklin. Daniel is the executive editor of The Economist and editor of The Economist's annual publication, The World In, fill in the year. Since joining The Economist in 1983, he has written about Soviet and Eastern European affairs, covered great European upheavals, been Britain editor, and later Washington bureau chief in the U.S. He is also the author and editor of a recent book, Megatech, Technology in 2050, which will be much of our topic for discussion tonight. For those of you here tonight, please see the program for a flyer on his full biography. So please join me in welcoming Daniel Franklin for a conversation about where technology is projected to be in 2050 and how it will affect our everyday lives. Well, thank you very much for joining us. I was intrigued by this because, among other things, I see futurism, or projections about the future, is a little like sci-fi. It's mostly a comment on the present, typically. But unlike the sort of negativity one often finds in the air these days about where society is going, or global warming, or the threat of massive computers running our lives, this is a rather optimistic text.
I think it is, and I should say clearly that this is 20 contributors. It's not just me who's written it. I've written the introduction, and I obviously chose the contributors. But so I didn't go out and ask people, please be optimistic. But collectively, I think the impression is, yes, it's not a depressing read, and it's not the sort of dystopian view that you will often get from fictional peering into the future. But there's plenty of, I think, hard questions that they ask, and most of the chapters also raise some quite tough issues and are not naive about the challenges that are faced. All that said, yes, I think you will not be depressed if you read this book.
And I think if you were looking for a flywheel that propels this, it's that we are in the early stages of a new kind of understanding, which a couple of your people talk about. Why don't you spend a moment on that?
Yeah, absolutely. The structure of the book is, first of all, to look at some of the drivers of technology. Nobody knows what technology is really going to look like in 2050. So one way of starting to think about this is to say, well, what do the fundamental sciences allow, or what stage have we reached in them, and what does that imply for the development of technology over the coming decades? So, for example, and perhaps most strikingly, I ask Frank Vilcek, who's a physicist, Nobel Prize winner out of MIT, and who's thought deeply about these questions, to say, where has physics got to, and what does that mean for the future of technology? And he makes a very striking, I think, brilliant chapter, by the way, brilliantly written, very succinct, very clear, striking statement that basically we have reached the stage in physics of explaining and having equations for the natural phenomena around us by and large. And what that means is that henceforth, technology can advance increasingly by calculation, by computation, rather than by experimentation. And that means it can go a lot faster.
Yeah, one thing he says in the chapter is that computers currently model airlines. So that's how we make an airplane. We model it rather than taking it to a wind tunnel. That's a later stage. And that will soon be true for nuclear power, or the understanding of a supernova, or how a cancer cell works inside the body. And so that more and more of our understanding can be generated through models, and therefore will accelerate the speed at which we
learn. You can apply to those models very extraordinarily powerful computers, more powerful than ever before. So the ability to calculate is not only there from the equations, but also from the power of the computers that can do the calculation. The other, I suppose, fundamental science that was looked at is biology, and by the state of biology, and particularly through the extraordinary advances in genome sequencing that have been seen in the past few years, and hyper exponential growth, something very akin to the sort of Moore's law that's applied to the computing industry is happening in biology. Now, biology is at a much earlier stage than physics. We're not at this sort of complete explanation of how things work yet, but we're at a stage where you can see that over the next 30 years, extraordinary strides are going to be made in that, extraordinary advances, thanks to this, essentially, through the ability to decode at a rate that we've, and at a price that we've never seen before. And so biology is sort of bubbling with youthful exuberance, and you can see that that is going to have an awful lot of implications for technology over the coming decades.
Now, looking at your biography, you've spent 34 years in the tire-kicking and thoughtful cynicism business, what's wrong with this picture? Do you find these overwhelmingly compelling arguments, or do you wonder if there isn't some level of heretofore undiscovered complexity that will just blow all this away?
Well, I suppose that's all. These people are much smarter than I am in their fields, so I sort of do find that compelling. Where I think the skepticism comes in, and the concluding chapter actually is devoted to this, is on the unintended consequences of technology. So, you know, and you look, if you take a historical view, you see that this has happened repeatedly with technology. It's not necessarily, mainly through ill will. It's not that people have willfully ignored the consequences of what they're doing, but often we haven't been aware of the consequences of what we're creating. So at the earlier stages of the Industrial Revolution, it wasn't obvious to people that we were building up a problem of global warming and climate change. It wasn't obvious that CFCs were going to punch a hole in the ozone layer. So you have these unintended consequences. My concern is that this sort of high velocity development that we're going to have will almost certainly have unintended consequences and things of a sort that we can't really get our minds around yet, but which have the potential to happen as fast as the science itself, the technology.
And of course,
itself.
Away from the science, the sort of universal caveat is, and then when you mix this in with human society, who knows what deviltry they'll get up to?
Yes, and I think it is the human interaction with science that is absolutely crucial, and I think that again is something that the concluding chapter looks at, is, you know, does science have a will of its own, sometimes there is quite a common view, I think, these days, that technology wants to do certain things, takes you inevitably in certain directions. And I think I would take issue with that again and say, actually, that we can't absolve ourselves of the responsibility for what this does.
We come along, too.
Yeah.
I should say for the room, we've spent a little bit of time in some high-level views. Practically, what gets talked about in the book is essentially the end of aging, abundant food, abundant leisure, the computation of a massive number of problems resulting in faster speed of discovery, a very low cost of manipulating the world, and a very high level of learning, new materials, a car that is essentially spun from carbon, and the Economist being beamed straight into your brain, which was a little past 2050, but he was... those were all things people talked about as near certainties in their view.
Yeah, and there's a sort of common thread to that, which I suppose is abundance, right?
Yeah.
So there's, you know, a lot of stuff is going to be more available, stuff that we thought of as being very scarce. Energy, you didn't mention, but that's another area where, you know, people think of energy being a very scarce resource, but and it seems perfectly possible that renewable energy develops very rapidly. Solar power is experiencing again the sort of exponential change that that other areas of technology are showing, that we'll have energy in abundance where once we thought we had a problem of scarcity.
But scarcity is also very important for the proper functioning of markets. People and institutions exploit the one thing they're good at to an extent others aren't, and that means there's a scarcity there. How do markets respond to a world of total abundance?
Well, first of all, I don't know if it's total abundance. There'll be some things that are abundance.
Weighted
and other things that are...
Insight
that
may
are,
still be...
and I think that there will always be new needs and things that are therefore scarce than they were before. But it does change where the money is made. You know, you see this, for example, in the telecoms industry where, you know, distance has basically disappeared. Some parts of the ecosystem of the telecoms have become very, very cheap and very commonplace. Others are still highly valued.
Yes, and the observation of behavior, which previously didn't factor into the economics at all, has become this new element that's the most valuable thing of all.
Yes, and as you mentioned, data will be abundant. You know, we know that we're going to be gathering more and more and more data. We're going to be embedding chips in more and more stuff. But the ability to interpret that data and deliver really useful information is another matter, and that will, I think, be a much more refined art where there will be lots of value to be had.
Mm-hmm. How well do you see government and other large-scale social institutions responding to a world like this?
Well, I think with difficulty because of the speed. So it's hard. Regulation is a difficult thing at the best of times. Hard to get the balance right between allowing development to take place, encouraging innovation, and protecting society from potential abuse, protecting consumers from potential monopolies, protecting harmful things from being done. But when you have this sort of speed of development, it becomes doubly hard. And actually, chapter after chapter makes exactly this point, that regulators are going to have a hard job keeping up with the pace of science. And medical technology is an obvious area where that is the case. Medical ethics, I think, are going to really struggle with, for example, the gene editing tools that are being created, or the regenerative medicine. You know, what human beings become is suddenly at issue, because we can alter our genetic makeup, and we will be able to alter the physical body parts that we have.
And enormous areas of the government are usually given over to some kind of protection of the weaker members of society, the very old in need of a pension, the very young in need of an education, those victims of crime in need of protection. And the society is moving forward based on those who are strong. So there's going to be a real mismatch there, isn't there?
There is, and I think one of the big worries in this respect is with what it will mean for the workforce and for generally the world of work. If clever computing robots increasingly make the traditional jobs that we've known today uncompetitive, then you risk having whole swathes of the labor force that are made no longer useful, and the social impact of that is potentially very great. Now, I'm a long-term optimist again on this. I think that we create new needs, we work with machines in new ways, we supplement machines. As happened with the Industrial Revolution, we will find new things to do. However, that doesn't necessarily happen on the same timescale that the old is destroyed, so we could have a very serious social problem along the way.
Work is important in some form or other because it's so closely tied up with identity. It's who you are in the world and how you add value. I raised this with a professor at MIT one time about when the jobs go away, what will people do? And he said, well, they'll entertain each other, but they'll work harder than ever to do it. You know, it'll be a real full-time job. And I found that an interesting paradox, because it seems like a life of leisure, but it's a very
calibrated kind of leisure. It used to be that a life of leisure was something that people really aspired to, and the aristocracy would revel in having leisured time to pursue gentlemanly pursuits and to be cultured or to enjoy the land and so on.
To have a pale skin to show you didn't work outside.
Exactly. Nowadays, it seems that the thing that is prized is to be forever busy and to be in more demand of your time than you could possibly have ever
thought. If you want to start a conversation in Silicon Valley, go to a dinner and talk about how little you sleep.
Right.
Everyone will talk about how little they
sleep.
But
this is the status symbol, right?
Exactly.
So this is, you don't want to say, oh, I sleep beautifully for 10 hours a day. I'm not bothered.
Yeah.
But maybe the point is that maybe culture will start to shift, and maybe leisure will be prized rather more than it has been before. That wouldn't necessarily be a bad thing.
One could hope. I wanted to get to the local industry, computing. There's a quote, computers will do for nuclear physics, stellar physics, material science, and chemistry what they have always done for aircraft design. Can you say a little more about what it will mean when calculation becomes such an integral part of all science, every major industrial activity, will there be a very few large companies? Will there be lots of startups? What do you think?
Well, one of the things that is sort of abundant is computing power. So I think that gives power to startups actually to be disruptive and do the kind of fresh thinking that can always happen. So I'm sort of fairly optimistic that will still come about. But I think what you do see is that in territory after territory, a great prize goes to the company that gets there first and dominates the space, and there are great economies of scale, and that can be quite hard to compete with after a while. So I think they will still face disruption as the technology moves on to the next thing, but you risk having territory that is occupied by very, very large companies. I think what also happens in this world that you're describing is that the barriers between different technologies start to break down. So technologies and sciences move into each other's territory.
We were talking about this before a little bit, when everything becomes a formula or a computation, the lines between physics and chemistry and biology already collapse, as they already do to some extent in the nanotechnology world, but that's going to be seen at a whole new scale.
And information technology sort of invades sector after sector. So again, if you take medicine, you know, the ability to compute and to gather data on diseases, on patients, on genetic makeup, this becomes a very, very important part of the puzzle of figuring out diseases. And so alliances or new players moving into this area becomes very, very likely, very plausible.
Which raises an interesting question. In this world, what would you like your granddaughter to study? How could someone be best prepared?
Well, you'd sort of expect the answer after what we've been talking about to be sort of a computer scientist or a someone who does this sort of data crunching brilliantly. I think actually I would go the other way and say that I would be very pleased if my grandchildren had a deep knowledge of history.
Mm.
I think we're going to need humanities just as much as we need sciences. And if you think of the financial crisis, for example, part of the problem there was not thinking historically enough. We were too wrapped up in the present. A lot of these, the first chapter in the book, actually, by my colleague Tom Standage, gives us a toolkit for looking at the tech future. And there's three things in that toolkit. One is science fiction. One is the sort of edge cases from the present. But the third thing is history mm-hmm. of history of science. Actually, you can learn a lot of how things are likely to develop by looking at, you know, what happened in the Victorian internet, which was the electric telegraph, for example. So I hope that we don't forget in all this techno-driven age the humanities. And even, I think, to make artificial intelligence or interaction with between machines and people work well, you will need to have people who work with the machines to make them more humane. So the humanities, again, will be deeply in demand, I hope.
To circle back to what we were saying earlier about abundance and scarcity, it's still going to be quite hard to encode empathy. And
yes.
It's going to be hard to encode
yes.
taste.
Yes, but not as probably as difficult as you might imagine. Because
you're scaring
me.
Well,
you know, again, I think if you want machines to be most effective in interacting with individuals, you have to, in a way, teach them to be empathetic, to ask questions, to listen to what's being said to them, not just blurt out answers. So I think that precisely understanding how empathy works and trying to get machines to mimic that as far as possible is going to be part of making them good.
I hadn't thought about that, but there is a rich industry to be built in computers that respond to visual cues well, and see how their computation is going over with their human owners.
You know, I think when things have really changed is when you go and see the doctor, and you say, actually, I'd rather speak to the machine, please, rather than to speak to the doctor, because you think that the machine will understand you better than the doctor will.
It's interesting you say history, because in Luciano Floridi's chapter, he talks about these great waves in which humanity's understanding itself has changed radically, and it tends to affect all sorts of social sensibilities, people's sense of themselves, people's sense of their relationship to God. Copernicus taking the sun from the center of things, right through to Freud taking our rational selves from the center of things. But in all of those cases, I don't think the inventors sort of thought, that's right, I'm going to change how humanity thinks of itself. But this time, this is an interesting period in history. We actually are building machines and building technologies that we pretty much know will make humanity unrecognizable to our present selves within two or three generations.
Yes. Well, Luciano, who's an ethics professor at Oxford University, he talks about actually the fourth revolution. The one you missed out was Darwin, I think. Mm. So it sort of, each of those other three changed the perception of humanity in the universe, or position in the amongst other creatures, or of consciousness. And here, I think it's a change of perception of humanity and intelligence. And what you get from that, I think, is a sense of, ultimately, one would hope that it's an understanding of what makes us, a heightened awareness of what makes us truly human.
Mm-hmm.
And no, we're not better than the best computer at playing chess or even Go now, but we have other qualities that that make us deeply human. And maybe by peeling away yet another layer of the myth of where we stand in the universe, we can understand our own humanity better, be more aware.
Mm-hmm. One of the great fears one finds about this world is a very intelligent and malevolent AI. Typically, someone will insert a picture of the Terminator. You know, the computers will come to kill us. Do you subscribe to this view? Do you think this is...
Well, some very smart people worry a lot about it. And, you know, Elon Musk and I think Bill Gates is worried about this. Stephen Hawking worried about it. Precisely in Luciano Floridi's chapter, he sort of takes issue with all that and says we're very far from that kind of future. But that's not to get away from the worry. He says, in his view, the worry is, you know, the machines are still actually, they do what they're told. We design the machines, but we also create the environment in which the machines can operate. And he worries that we will create these environments designed around the machines at the expense of human needs, if we're not careful. And sort of bit by bit, we may create a machine-friendly environment that ends up not being terribly human-friendly.
That's not artificial intelligence. That's artificial stupidity.
Yeah, well, yes, but it could all too easily. You can see how it can happen. Yes, you can see how it happened that, you know, you're with this stubborn thing that only knows how to do one thing, and it's not going to adapt. So you end up adapting to it. You end up, you create the environment that helps it operate. It's like being in a marriage or a partnership where one partner is just deeply stubborn, the other is quite adaptable. The adaptable one ends up adjusting to the stubborn one. So we may end up adjusting time and again to the needs of the machine, and that over time and repeatedly, that can be, I think, perilous for how the overall organization of things works.
Mm. Let's do a couple of scenarios, if we could. What do you think medical education will look like in 15 or 20 years?
Well, I think the rise of the data machine, you know, I've sort of fancifully invented a company that is that corners the market in the medical world called DKB, which is Doctor Knows Best. And this is some super machine that has all this sort of clever database and ability to compute. So the machines are just going to get very, very good at this stuff. My colleague Ken Cukier, who writes about a data-driven world, says actually that the computer is going to be the smartest doctor in the world. So if that's the case, the doctor has to learn how to be, to add value around that, not just on that, has to not just be the offer the best diagnosis, because the machine might be able to do that, but the best judgment, the best interpretation, explaining this to patients, possibly the best out of the box thinking that can do what machines can't do. So I think medical education will have to include a lot, as indeed legal education as well, a lot more understanding of what machines will add to this, and a lot more understanding of patient interaction, because that will be where it will often be better than machines.
And what will health look like?
Well, radically potentially transformed by the ability to do things like have regenerative medicine and replacing tissues or whole body parts that are worn out. A lot more targeted therapy through this understanding of the pathways of diseases, particularly with specific genomes. So we, instead of having sort of blunderbuss approach to a class of cancer, you can tell much more accurately which drug is likely to work for which particular person. So healthcare potentially further expanded lifespans. We've already seen a great expansion of human life in the rich world, in particular in recent decades, and that can be stretched further by technology.
One more, nature. If we're managing everything, does nature exist?
Well, nature exists, of course, but we've already tamed a lot of nature, and we've altered nature around us, and we will continue to do so. I think one area where this is quite intriguing is in the area of food. So do we eat meat that comes from live animals, or do we eat meat that is from cell cultures from animals? So you can imagine a genuine factory farming where we're farming animal products, meat and perhaps milk and eggs, that are not produced from live animals, but are produced in factory from cell culture. And you could see how that would pit the sort of animal rights lobby, who might be thrilled about that, against the Frankenfoods lobby, who might be concerned about it. So it would be quite intriguing to watch that battle playing out.
You know, while this has been taking place in the last 5 or 10 years, it's been underway, and I think people intuit that much of this, perhaps not in the way it's said in the book, but much of this is taking place now and will continue to grow. Some of the most powerful social and political movements, and you can look at Brexit, you can look at the elections in the U.S., you can look at, in a very different way, and I say this without prejudice to make a parallel, ISIS or Al-Qaeda, or the Arab Spring, are movements where great numbers of people say no.
Yes.
We're not going to do that, and they don't really have, it seems, a very positive programmatic alternative. They just want the future to go away, and they want some return that is impossible to capture to how things were, and it's a myth how things were. Do you think society is responding spasmodically or badly to this change? They already feel it.
Well, I think a lot of that is a very understandable reaction to the pace of change that in many cases makes large swathes of society uncomfortable. And so it's a very human response. Often, ironically, it uses technology very smartly in that response.
Yeah.
So, you know, all those campaigns that you mentioned were very adept at deploying the modern technology in order to turn the clock back, which is
very good in social media.
Very savvy, very, very good at social media. And in the case of Al-Qaeda or IS, very good at other forms of science and technology as well. Mm. Perhaps, quite scarily so. But I don't think, I don't think that's destined to, as you say, you can't turn the clock back, at least only, you can perhaps do so only temporarily. And I think that these forces that we've been discussing are really terribly powerful over time.
Presumably, yeah, those who embrace them will be advantaged. And that's historically been the strong argument.
I think those who embrace them will be advantaged, and they're very seductive, or a lot of them are in any case very seductive, even for the political forces that you've been describing. I mean, they are not going to reject new medical treatments that are on offer. They're not. They don't reject new communications. They don't go into some sort of purdah of silence. They have access to all the modern communications and will use data very effectively.
A very compelling chapter on the future of war.
Yes.
And the state-run violence in various forms.
And part
forms.
Of the worry about that is that the strategic balance may be upset by the accessibility of some very powerful tools such as cyber warfare and the use quite highly but not very expensive destructive technologies that could be obtained by poorer states or even non-state players.
Mm-hmm. And as you worked on this book, as you saw these chapters come in, how did it change your thinking about the world to come?
Encourage me in the sense that most were very full of the possibilities and the speed of how things might change and the kind of scale of the transformative impact in sector after sector. I think that was an eye-opener. I would say that it also did strike me, and you're right that it's broadly positive book, but that again, contributor after contributor does point to the things that we need to be concerned about. So that, to me, was very real as well. You just mentioned the chapter on warfare, and that's a prime example.
Yes, I mean, we're in something of a barbell world where people have never been more empowered and people have never been more under control. People have never had more information and people have never been more confused by things. And we speak in extremes like this all the time now. That tends to speak to an unsustainable situation. Something's going to give here, and presumably will over the next 30 years.
Well, something clearly politically has given in certain countries. I think the concern is that something very, very big gives in, we've also got the power to do all sorts of damage and Frank Vilcek, in his chapter, talks about three concerns in particular: nuclear destruction, environmental destruction, and he does worry about AI-enabled warfare. So the hope is that over the next 30 years, we human beings are responsible enough not to let those things go as far as they potentially could.
Well, we have some questions from the audience, and the first one speaks to this, actually. An audience member asks, will the Flynn effect continue? That is to say, will people continue to become smarter in tandem with technology?
I think technology can enhance us. I think that is certainly the case. And if you look at a technology such as, I don't know, this is what is meant by the Flynn effect, but mm-hmm. If you look at...
I saw it and I thought about the national security.
Yes, exactly. I don't know whether that involves getting smarter in any way. But if you think about augmented reality, so where you can have people with information very accessibly provided in real time, overlaid on the real world, that enables you to do things more efficiently, for
yes.
example. Clearly technology can make us dumber as well if we're not careful, but I think technology can enhance our capabilities. One, an interesting little bit part of, again, the Vilcek chapter talks about how technology can enhance our, literally enhance our senses, that the human sensorium is very restricted. And with technology, you can see sights, hear sounds, and get access to a much wider range of the senses. And he predicts that it will enhance our human sensorium enormously. So that's
really interesting, too, because that represents whole new areas of data to be collected and seen, you know, the behavior of infrared at scale for
something.
But
also
like
potentially
that.
You could imagine that that could have enormous artistic potential, mm-hmm. creative potential.
Mm-hmm. And similarly, the questioner asks, will emotional and mental health benefit as people self-actualize through technology? And there's something to be said for that. We are now in contact with so many different people, and empathy can be improved.
Yes, we can make connections much, much more readily, mm-hmm. and I think gain greater understanding in that way, yes.
I've gone and become positive on you. So here's what I need, a good typhoon. You mentioned controlling nature. Is there anything you've encountered around the prevention of natural disasters? Can we stop earthquakes, typhoons, hurricanes?
Well, that isn't something that anybody talks about in the book, and obviously earthquakes here are particularly relevant, but one imagines that it can't hurt to have more and more data.
I would
and
say
our ability to understand those phenomena has improved with more and more data collection. We still could do with much, much, much more data on parts of the world that are actually still relatively have been inaccessible underneath the oceans, for example.
Yeah.
And I think those are areas where we will, in this sort of time frame, get much better data and perhaps get better understanding then of predictive powers of those things.
We won't bolt the plates of the Earth,
no.
But we will become better at remote sensing.
Exactly.
And we will become better at new materials that, like nature, can sway and not just remain rigid during such things. So there is a positive there. Here's a good question. It sounds like you are discussing the impact of technology on the educated class. What about the implication on the working man who just lost his job to a robot? Do you have optimism there?
I think that's a really tough one, and I think that is where the biggest sense of concern and real worry lies, and that's why the sort of the answer often is more education, better education, more flexibility in workforce, but that takes time,
mm-hmm.
and that does not solve the problem of the person who sees their job immediately under threat. So it's not as if technology won't offer all sorts of potential benefits to those workers as well, or those human beings as well, but it doesn't necessarily offer them the prospect of a job, and that's fairly fundamental.
Well, again, it does. This challenges another area of government, what education looks like. And we still seem to have this promise that you'll finish. You'll finish at 18, you'll finish at 22, and you'll be set up. That will be sufficient amounts of education. And very little in this acceleration indicates that's a successful model.
No, and there's a lot more talk, therefore, of lifelong learning and the need to constantly have access and sort of reconnect. And technology itself can clearly contribute a lot to that, can offer very tailored courses much more, potentially much, much more widely by making them available over internet platforms, by working out what your needs are and then answering those. So there is an interesting contribution in the book which says that precisely technology, having created a lot of inequality, offers the potential in areas like education, in areas like health and the law, to offer more access more cheaply and to be part of the solution to inequality. Again, that's I think it could also do both at the same time. It could be part of the solution while also continuing to create divides.
And by definition, if there is that kind of education going on, it has to take place while people are working. You will not break from work. You will be educating while at work. I've seen some intriguing stuff around machines that, in addition to interacting with people, educate them while they're interacting with them, help them learn a new task.
Yes. But the problem yet again is the people who are better at continuous education are going to be the people who've had more of the education in the first place, who better have the tools to learn.
Mm. Do you believe in universal basic income? Will we just pay people to live?
Well, this whole idea arises precisely out of these concerns, that if you're going to have a whole swathe or whole great numbers in society who can't have work, maybe part of the answer is to have a universal basic income in order to have dignity and to avoid revolution, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's something that deserves to be carefully looked at. I'm myself somewhat wary of the idea because, first of all, it'd be very expensive. It's liable to raise all sorts of other issues of what you do at your borders and whether who you let in to have access to this universal basic income and what it might do to incentives to work. I mean, we know from welfare systems that there's a whole debate about whether welfare at some level can discourage work and can be demotivating rather than motivating. So I think the idea is a difficult one, but an interesting one and an important one to explore. And that I think it's part of, you know, when we had the Industrial Revolution, there was a massive policy response on a very big scale, providing universal education, providing different sort of taxation. We probably need something on an equivalent scale. Whether this particular idea is the right one, I think that's an open question.
Yes, and an audience member asks, who would pay, the government or corporations? And of course, the government would receive its money from individuals or corporations.
So it may amount partly to the same same thing. But I think behind the question is also an interesting thought about how much responsibility do corporations have for this world that they're creating. And I think some of the larger companies do worry about the social consequences of where these technologies can lead and are very actively engaging in trying to make sure that they can contribute in some ways, and partly as protecting themselves against the risks of future upheaval if they don't.
Mm, and there's a very interesting challenge on the tension between corporations, which even today are seen as having national headquarters or national characters, and the need to derive data and insight from the best minds across borders, so that corporations and governments will increasingly be antagonistic to each other.
Potentially, although I think we see time and again that geography still does mean something. And Say more. Well, I think the state has shown itself to be, you know, but sometimes people have thought, well, international companies can roam freely,
we're all global,
but actually the state, turns out, is pretty powerful in making regulations, and when the state decides to intervene, corporations have to listen pretty hard. Now they can move money around to some extent. They can try to escape to areas of easier regulation. But pretty often they have fairly firm bases somewhere, and they have to pay attention.
Mm-hmm. An audience member asks, "What do you think the consensus thinking would have been in 1967, looking at the future of technology today?" There's two interesting things about that question. One, people still think 2050 is 50 years away. It's now 33 years away. It's coming at us fast.
Yes. But even 30 years ago, I think, you know, people would obviously have got a lot wrong.
Sure.
And, you know, the iPhone is only 10 years old, and that ushered in a sort of smartphone revolution that has changed the way that we operate our lives quite fundamentally in many cases, and that didn't exist. We wouldn't have imagined it necessarily 30 years ago. So I think that the question does rightly say, well, you know, there is an extreme difficulty of having to, of saying you know what's going to happen in 30 years' time. Of course we don't. What we do is we make educated guesses.
Yes, and it is a snapshot of the present.
Absolutely.
You know, but... speaking to where that's concerned in this area, 30 years ago, many people could have pointed to Moore's Law by that point. It was 20 years on and said, computers are going to become smaller and more powerful, and people bet industries on that and did quite well. You see an end of Moore's Law coming.
Yes. I mean, Moore's Law can't carry on working forever. It reaches the sort of subatomic scale.
You can only make transistors so dense
right.
and so cheap.
So there's probably a little bit of mileage left, but not all that much. But that mileage is important because we're talking about, you know, still exponential growth on even extraordinarily improved efficiency. So that matters. And it's a serious question, therefore, since we've talked so much about data, computing power, and so on, can this computing revolution, will it have the fuel to carry on crunching ever more data and ever more demanding difficulties put in front of the computing industry to cope with all this?
Mm.
The answer in the chapter that addresses this most directly is not with the same ease as before, not with the same metronomic inevitability and reliability that Moore's Law delivered. But yes, it can go on through a combination probably of different ruses. One is to put more in the cloud, an area you know very well. Another is to actually get better in the design of what's of software, because people precisely knew that Moore's Law was going to help out with ever greater efficiency. You didn't have to design your software necessarily as energy efficiently as you would have done, or as memory efficiently as you would otherwise have done. So there's gains to be had there. You can get gains by stacking things, and then potentially other forms of storage and memory can come into play, such as DNA, very efficient potentially way of storage, and even quantum computing over this sort of timescale, I think, could turn out to be very significant.
Yes. Moore's Law, as powerful as it is, had a kind of cadence of two
yes.
years. And the industry really built around that. I think it was surprising for the industry to see how that changed when cloud computing and mobility came into play, because you had salesmen, you had engineers, you had software developers who built every 2 years or every 4 years, and they assumed companies would, every other rev of Moore's Law, they'll buy new computers and we'll sell them more software and we'll sell them more screens and we'll sell them new things. And since cloud, virtualization, mobility, factors such as this have come into play, there's just this kind of continuous upgrade. There's just yeah. more computing and there's more software at all time, which is one reason people sit around at dinner and talk about how they don't sleep. There's no break
yes, no
anymore.
No end to it.
Yeah.
But it was a terribly powerful thing before Moore's Law. That
it continues to be.
That's why I say, you know, the word metronome, I think, describes it very well. There was this sort of metronome to the computing industry, and everybody adjusted their rhythm to it.
Right. My point is, as we add more of that and we start to have things like many sort of two-way sensors contributing at all times, or swarm robotics where many robots at the edge are delivering information and upgrading themselves based on what the other 200 are experiencing, that acceleration is likely to continue even as Moore's Law may be threatened.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are other means to it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So fast as it seemed, it's going to be faster.
It's going to be faster still, and Moore's Law, and you know, again, you do have to think, well, in expecting everything to go fast, you have to ask the question, what could put on the brakes or what could constrain all this? Moore's Law, I don't think, is sometimes put as one of the things that would constrain it, but actually I don't think it is going to.
So, apropos of the empathy and AI questions, today when you ask Amazon's Alexa, how intelligent are you? She answers, I like to think I'm fairly intelligent, even though it's artificial. Is that the first step to encoding humility, sort of?
Well, somebody told Alexa to say that, I
of
presume.
Course.
So that's a human humility on behalf of a machine. So I think it is part of what we were talking about earlier, of trying to sort of create empathy in a machine. And Alexa has a lot of empathy, I think, sort of.
And of course, that encourages the person to talk to it more often. And in a less formal way, which helps its ability to learn.
Sometimes too often, when we had one of our podcasts on Amazon Echo, and there were many examples of saying, Alexa, do this. And when we had lots of responses saying, please don't do this, because my Alexa just went ahead and did what you told it to do.
Someone asks, what is technology and what is not technology? Which is an interesting philosophical problem. The rotary phone versus the smartphone. When does something become a piece of technology? In a sense, it's all technology.
Yes, that's what I was
going back
would
to
have
when
said,
you
that
start
it is,
chipping a flint.
It is all technology, and sometimes I think here in this particular part of the world, you tend to think of technology as just information technology, and there's all sorts of other technology that is just as important as technology as well.
But there is also a very real observation behind that, which is, the technology we have with information technology, for want of a better term, it kind of enchants objects because they learn from you and they deliver more value. And so we are in a somewhat different technology realm of things that improve themselves.
Yes, and I think when you get into sort of self-learning smart machines, that again is a speeding up of how things work. But it doesn't mean that other apparently dumber machines are not technology. I think it's still all technology.
Mm-hmm. What does the future do to the population curve? Will we still go to 9 or 10 billion people?
Over this sort of time frame that we're talking about, I don't think that what we've been talking about has much impact on population.
Yeah.
Trends. That's sort of a lot of that is baked in, we probably therefore still do go to about 10 billion or so by 2050, hence the need to be able to feed 3 billion or
synthetic
so
food
more
starts
synthetic
to sound pretty
or
good.
Much more efficient, much less food waste. I mean, more and a lot of we've been talking mainly about technology in the rich world, but there's also the application of technology to the developing world, which can have an enormous impact. And so the bringing of already existing technology to those parts of the world can be very significant. There's a chapter in the book by Melinda Gates imagining if every woman in the world had a smartphone.
Mm-hmm.
And the impact that could have, and it could be enormous in areas such as access to finance. These are often women who don't have any, who are excluded from the financial system. Farming, incredibly important. Actually, women, most farmers in the world are women, and a majority are women, and the information that they can have through smartphones can be incredibly important in improving efficiency there, or healthcare. All these areas are potentially can have a huge impact, and that's technology that exists today. You don't need to invent something new for that. You also find that in some of those parts of the world, you get strange spurts in technology that moves faster than elsewhere, and I think particularly of the development of mobile payments in Kenya through M-Pesa. This was somewhere that didn't have many people didn't have access to a banking system. Mobile payments developed, and you could make payments more easily than at the time than you could in America. And this was Kenya.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the benefits of the next billion people to come online and access this very high level of information, which is a benefit of the cloud or of computation everywhere, the first billion largely could get it from a library and then a desktop computer and then a laptop computer. The next billion will arrive in a world where there's so much stored in a few places that they'll access it by their phones. An interesting development there is the relative abundance of geniuses we'll discover. Albert Einstein's last great bit of luck was to be born in Germany and have means to publishing. Had he been a goat herd in some obscure corner of Central Asia, he would have just been a strange man on a hill.
That's a wonderful thought. And in fact, One of the ideas in this analysis of how technology could be part of the solution to inequality is the discovery of talent, that technology can help you discover where the talent is, and talent that may otherwise have been hidden can be discovered. And an example, small example, is of the way that the Israeli defense forces seek out talented people with the help of technology and discover some extraordinary talents that would otherwise not have been discovered at all, who've gone on to do great things, in some cases become technology entrepreneurs themselves. So if you can imagine that happening on a much larger scale, yes, the genius productivity
will be great.
Not only the geniuses who are already there, but they will be empowered to do greater things, to use their genius.
Unfortunately, I say that, and then the tire-kicking cynic in me also says, yes, and so will the relative quotient of evil, malevolent, and pushy people increase.
With access to lots of means. I think the worry is not necessarily that more of them will come forward, but that they will have access to very powerful tools.
Yes. And do you believe there is a way of addressing that?
I think, short of a massive surveillance state? We always have to be vigilant. That's always been a condition of human nature. We have to do it, continue to be vigilant, and we have to probably deploy technology in the cause of that vigilance as well. And we already do, of course, but that will only increase.
Somewhat in the based on that fearful prospect, an audience member appropriately asks, although I am generally an optimist, living in the Bay Area, I find there is a dominant view that all technology developments are good. Many are useful, but are they necessary? Do we need to go to Mars? Do we need so much automation?
Well, technology is not necessarily either good or bad. It just is, and we can make it better or worse. I think it often develops or takes off if people find it useful. So, going to Mars is very expensive. So if you're going to go to Mars, you're going to have some people who think it's an extremely important, valuable thing to do that's worth spending a lot of time and effort pursuing. And that may be large numbers of people. It may be a government, or it may be an individual who thinks that this is essential to create alternative colonies to our human race, which might otherwise destroy itself here.
It is also a characteristic of human nature so far to say yes to a new technology. I can't think of a people who have looked at something and said, no, we don't need that.
Well, but
short of the cobalt bomb.
But hang on, there are plenty of technologies that fail, right? There are plenty of technologies
they failed in the marketplace.
That fail in the marketplace, that don't get anywhere, that prove to be actually, after all, not terribly useful. So
that's
a very
different
high
from
failure
saying,
rate.
Well, let's just not build that. They try it and it doesn't work.
Well, they might try it and it doesn't work, or it may work and people just don't find it terribly exciting.
Right. A questioner on the singularity, Ray Kurzweil's idea that we will, I suppose you'd say, just our minds will disappear into the machine and we will live forever in a idealized state of high awareness.
I find it very hard to get my mind around that, I must say. I don't think we'll get there by 2050.
I've seen the diagrams. I find it a remarkably spiritual point of view for a rational man.
Yeah.
What do you think will stay the same? What are some things that will remain durably true? An excellent question.
Yes. Well, I think we will remain mortal. I think we will remain.
I was afraid of that.
I think we will remain fallible, deeply fallible. I think that the ability to be frustrated with the world around us, but also the ability to be excited and surprised by the world around us.
But that's the wellspring of creativity and technological change.
Yeah. That those will stay the same, and the fact that this is a extraordinarily challenging business to share the planet with so many other people and so many other forms of life. I think that will remain unchanged.
That's interesting you say that, because to circle back, though we may know the processes underlying physics or biology or chemistry, that doesn't mean we're in a world of pure engineering. There is still plenty to discover.
Plenty to discover about that, and also about human nature.
Mm-hmm. And the interactions below these things, which may be thrilling very nearly in a spiritual sense, too. I was going to ask you what you thought the future of religion was in all this.
You're
qualified.
I think it sort of goes in two directions. That I think rationalism is probably on the rise, as opposed to religiosity globally on the world. But extreme, intense forms of religion are also on the rise simultaneously. I think. You know, there's a big debate, and actually this topic was addressed in the previous book, to the precursor of this book, Mega Change, which I edited a few years ago, which talked about big tectonic shifts in the world. And there was a chapter on religion in that which took issue with the idea that religion is broadly on the rise again, and said actually secularism on the rise. In Europe, certainly, that's the case. The argument was that in America, too, beneath the surface, that's actually the case. I think that the rise of these incredibly powerful technologies both has the impact of having people search for more meaning, and that can make them turn to religion, but it can also just make them rely more and more on the technologies and decide that this is actually the rational world that they live in.
Mm. This may be a hard question for you to answer, because you have such a rich palette of people you talk to. But what do you wish you knew more about?
Oh, most things. Most things.
Specifically?
I mean, I'm not actually very knowledgeable about science. I didn't train as a scientist. I was a linguist. So I wish I had more knowledge about science and about history. As I said before, I think that's very valuable. I would very much like to understand more about many other parts of the world. I find it fascinating how people live in different parts of the world, and that's something that, you know, life is unfortunately not long enough to go to enough places, experience in depth enough other places. That would be my, if I were to live again, I would like to live somewhere else to experience it.
That's the ultimate scarcity experience. Yeah. You can never have enough of it.
Yeah.
That's very well put. The next wave, let's close on a question very near and dear to the valley, disruption. What technology do you see coming up that will be the most disruptive?
Well, I suspect that something to do with this biotechnology revolution is going to be very disruptive, and maybe crossing the true disruption may come from technologies that cross over to the boundaries from where they've traditionally lain to somewhere else, and start to change things in ways that nobody foresaw. And I think that might happen with the biotechnology industry.
Yes, if you can start to farm anywhere and rapidly, you're going to throw apart an enormous supply chain that stretches across the entire globe.
And it can also disrupt, I think, manufacturing. We make things in different ways using a combination of organic and inorganic materials. I mean, there could be ways in which they're truly surprising that it starts to impact.
Well, you leave us on a wonderful and intriguing note. I'm afraid that's all the time we have tonight. On behalf of World Affairs, I ask you to join me in thanking Daniel Franklin for this excellent discussion. Many thanks to you, the audience, for your wonderful questions. If you'd like to read more, Daniel Franklin's book, Megatech, Technology in 2050, is available tonight, and he will be signing copies at the book table, though I understand you do have a flight to catch.
I have a flight to catch, but
rush
I will
to that
happily
table.
Sign copies. Yes.
Let's give him a hand. Good night.
Thank you very much.